Dear student, in part 3, now we are going to discuss the consumption function and the saving function in detail. So, as I have told you in earlier part, that the consumption function relating to consumption and income, and the saving function is relating to saving and income. So, here now in detail, we are going to discuss the consumption function. The consumption function is one of the most important relationship in all macroeconomics. So that means we are right now dealing with the you are taking the course of macroeconomics. So in macroeconomics, consumption function is one of the most important topics. So the consumption function shows the relationship between the level of consumption expenditures and the level of disposable income. Disposable income, as we have discussed earlier, is the income minus taxes. The remaining part is the disposable income. This concept introduced by Keynes after Great Depression, the most famous economist that come into the horizon is the Keynes. He gave the different school of different concepts regarding the economics, and the consumption function is one of them. So it is this idea. So the concept of consumption function is given by Keynes. The basic idea behind this concept is that it is based on the hypothesis that there is a stable, listen carefully, that there is a stable relationship between empirical relationship between consumption and income. What this hypothesis is saying, that there is a stable empirical relationship between consumption and income. With the help of example, we can see this consumption function more closely. So as we have discussed before, table 21.2, which is 21.3, here the details of any specific family is income is given, specific families income and savings and consumption is given in this table. So and in this graph, basically the all the disposable income which is mentioned in here in point in column 1 is given on the horizontal axis. Okay, and on the vertical axis we have the consumption expenditures. So this line is 45 degree line is the and this one is the consumption function. So this 45 degree line basically play a very important role while explaining the consumption function. You can simply it helps you differentiate in between consumption and saving. So look closely in this function, and here point B is basically the break-even point, and we have discussed earlier that the point B, which is 25,000, is the break-even point of that specific family, where that family is neither saving or nor dissaving. So that's why it is the break-even point, and that's why the consumption function is intersecting the 45 degree line over here. So here neither you have the saving nor you have the dissaving. The gap between 45 degree line and the consumption function is basically shows the saving or dissaving. Means if it is below the 45 degree line, that means here you are saving. If it is above the 45 degree line, that means you are dissaving. So here the point A basically you can see from the table. At point A, your disposable income is $24,000 and your expenditures or consumption expenditures are $24,200. That means you are dissaving $200. So this graph simply shows that at point A, which is point, look closely in the consumption function, the line of consumption function is above the 45 degree line. So this gap basically shows the dissaving. Whenever, keep in your mind and listen closely, whenever consumption function line is above the 45 degree line, that gap shows the dish saving, means you are taking loan in order to fulfill your consumption expenditures. So in here, in case of, just look at the vertical distancing in between x-axis and y-axis. So here E is the point is on 45 degree line, and E double dash is the point on the consumption function. So here you can see the E double dash basically is on the 45 degree line, and the red color E shows the point is on the consumption function line. So here this is the vertical distance, basically this one vertical distance, we know this we can call it vertical distancing. So every time if you want to show the shows the difference between saving and dissaving, you can show it by the help of vertical distancing method. So here you have E to E double dash, so shows the saving function of any family at point E. So here if you this is the 20, when the income is 28,000, the family is basically saving. So we can see from over here, so you can see that at point E, when a specific family's income is 28,000, so specific family's consumption expenditure is 27,400. So that means 28 minus if you simply 27,000 your income minus your consumption, the leftover part is your saving, which is 600. So that means at point E, your savings are 20, your savings are 600. Your current consumption is 28,000, but your consumption is 27,000 something. So that means basically you are saving at that point. So next is if you want to see the other, at point G, your income is that specific family income is 30,000, and that family consumption is 29,000. That means that family is saving $1,000. So here at point G, so as the saving is increasing, the gap between saving consumption function and 45 degree line is increasing, so vertical distancing is increasing. So simply the at point B, neither you are saving nor you are deceiving. At point E, the saving you are saving around $600, and at point G, you are that specific family is saving around $600. So this concept, keep in your mind, this concept regarding the consumption function is given by the Keynes. So if you have any question regarding this graph, you can ask during the online session. I'm happy to answer your question. So each of income consumption combination is represented by a single point, and the points are then connected by a smooth curve, okay, which is known as by the consumption function. The relationship between consumption and income, you can see in graph 21.2 in your in chapter number 21, investment and saving, and the book I have already referred to you is the Samuelson's. So again, I'm going to explain you the break-even point. The break, you to understand the figure, it is helpful to look at the 45 degree line. So keep it your point. Here we have the 45 degree line draw in this graph. The because the vertical and horizontal axis have exactly the same scale, the 45 degree line has a very special property. At listen carefully now. At any point on the 45 degree line, the distance up from horizontal axis, which is consumption, exactly equal to the distance across from the vertical axis, which is your disposable income. Okay, your disposable income is on your vertical axis, and your consumption is on your vertical axis. So again, listen carefully. At any point on the 45 degree line, the distance up from horizontal axis, the distance up from the horizontal axis, which is consumption, up means you have to take the vertical, exactly equal to the distance across from the vertical axis, which is shown by disposable income. You can use your eyes or any ruler to verify this fact. The 45 degree line tells us immediately whether consumption spending is equal to, greater than or less than the disposable income. The point where the consumption schedule intersects the 45 degree line is the break even point, which is point B. The break even point is the level of disposable income at which households just break even. So I have discussed earlier that the break even point is at point B in figure 21.2. Here, what break even point basically explain? Here at point B, consumption expenditures exactly equals the disposable income. The household is neither a borrower nor a saver. So whatever income he has, that family is consuming all their income on their consumption expenditure. So this is the explanation of break even point. So if you have any question, bache, you can ask during the online session. So try to see the distance between each point in this graph, so you can explain the concept in a better way. So now we are going towards to the consumption function. So the saving function, we have cleared the consumption function. Now we are going towards the saving function. So as I have discussed earlier, that the consumption and saving both function are basically dependent on the income. So they are not independent, they are dependent on income. If income increases, your saving increases. If your income decreases, your saving decreases. If your consumption, if your income increases, your consumption increases. If your income decreases, your consumption decreases. So that means both of these functions are basically dependent on your income, because increase or decrease in both function in both variables is highly dependent on your income. So now we move towards the saving function. The saving function shows the relationship between the level of saving and income. This is shown graphically at figure 21.3 here in this graph. Again, we show disposable income on the horizontal axis and the level of saving on vertical axis. And now what we are going to do, you can see little bit are different in the manufacturing of graphical analysis of consumption and saving. We have seen that saving might be negative because when your income lower than your consumption expenditure, then you have to borrow from someone. So that's why you can see at point A, basically here we have the dissaving, here we have the negative value of saving. That's why it shows by negative saving. So from point zero, you have the already you are instead of saving, you are dissaving. So from basically your graph always start from point zero to so on. So but because you are at point A already borrowing from someone instead of saving, so that's why negative value are below the point zero. So this is shown in graphically in figure 21.3. again, we show disposable income on the horizontal axis, but now saving, whether negative or positive in amount, is on the vertical axis. So either savings are negative or positive, it's shown by on the vertical axis. The saving function comes directly from figure 21.2. how? Now you are going to answer me during the online session how this saving function is comes directly from the figure 21.2. Things logically, you can get the idea very easily while searching this answer. Keep in your mind the concept of vertical distancing, so you can easily able to answer this question. So figure 20 saving function, simply shows that when your income is 24 at point 8, when your income is $24,000, you are spending more than your income. That's why you are spending like 20 at table at table 21.3, you simply see that when your income is $24,000, you are spending $24,200. So you are saving minus 200. At point B, neither you are saving nor you are deceiving. At point C, your income is 26,000 and you are saving $200. So this picture simply depict the that at each level of income, how much you are basically save from your income. So 24,000 you have instead of saving, you have deceiving. At when your income is 25,000, neither you are saving nor you are deceiving. At point C, you are saving 200 because your income is now 25,200. So you are spending. Let me see one more time. So in point C, your income is 26,000 and your consumption expenditures is 25,800. So that means you are saving $200. So and so on, and then at point E again saving you can see at point E how much you have the saving. At point E, you are saving $600 because your income now is 20. That specific family's income is $28,000 and they are saving $27,400. So this is their saving is $600 and so on. So simply you can get the idea of the saving function. So if you understand consumption function, then the understanding of saving function is quite easy. So this is your this is our part 3. In next part we are going to do the marginal propensity to consume and the marginal propensity to save. So here this is the end of part 3. Now we are going